Attention all you rule breakers, you misfits and troublemakers, all you free spirits and pioneers, all you visionaries and nonconformists.
Everything the establishment has told you is wrong with you is actually what's right with you. You see things others don't. You are hardwired to change the world.
You are listening to the Spiritual Activist Radio Show, and I am Rahasya, Uncensored. Where we look at the world not as it is, but as we know it can be, if and only if we have the courage to question the answers we've been given. This is our world, and it's time for us to take it back. Oh, welcome once again to the Spiritual Activist Radio Show. And today we're going to be talking with Robert Schoch. Now, I met Robert Schoch through John Anthony West. And John Anthony West was instrumental in predating the pyramids and the Sphinx back closer to its original time. And Robert Schoch is pretty much the academic side of that. Robert Schoch has a strong academic background, and it was interesting getting him to talk about aliens and extraterrestrial intervention and all of this, because most academics don't like to touch on that subject. And I have to apologize for some of the sound, because we had a bad connection a couple of places, but it's well worth listening to what he has to say about our ancient civilization and what's really going on this planet and our heritage. So let's talk to Robert Schoch.
So what do you have to say about the yuga cycle of the ages and our conscious awakening? Because I just interviewed Barbara Marx Hubbard yesterday. And she was talking about this, and it made me aware of the fact that if we don't wake up to a new level of consciousness, like Einstein once said, if we don't, we're never going to come up with the solutions to the problems from the same level of awareness that created the problems. So we have to almost hope and have faith, but it seems like there's a lot of evidence that we are going through a transformation. And even ancient traditions are pointing to this, even from 13,000 years ago. What would you have to say to that?
I think that's absolutely the case. We have in ancient traditions around the world, and I've been looking at this very closely, so you have it in every hemisphere around the world, on every continent, this concept of if they don't call it the yuga cycle one place, they call it by something else.
Yeah, exactly. And do you see
the same trend, the same pattern, the same concept of essentially going through a cycle, going through we'll call it a golden age, silver age, bronze age, iron age, going through some cultures will talk in terms of processional cycle, a yuga cycle, the cycle of the different suns of the Maya. The Mayan cycle that we've heard so much about. But what I'm impressed by is it's a very similar concept in numerous different ancient cultures. And when you start seeing similarities like that, to me, it says that there's probably some real underlying basis. And I'm convinced with my own work on ancient civilizations that there is an underlying basis for that. And you just mentioned 13,000 years ago, there's a lot of evidence that we had very high, very sophisticated civilization cultures at the end of the last ice age. And these went down, there was a huge demise. There was actually, I think, some kind of catastrophic events at the end of the last ice age. We went into essentially a dark age, and then we came out of it again, but we go through these cycles. We go through these rings in civilization. And I would say not just civilization, but really our mental being, our mentality, our way of thinking, our different mental abilities, if I could put it that way.
Yeah, and this new consciousness seems to be dragging some of us, kicking and screaming, but towards an idea of oneness, which is in direct conflict with ego personalities and the idea of limitedness and resources and fear and setting up territorialness. All of these old ideas are trying to fade away, but at the same time, they're trying to grab hold and unfortunately, they have the military behind them and governments. But as we enter into this new age, it seems like there's something awakening underneath the fabric of space and time. There's a consciousness coming through. It almost reminds me of, have you ever seen these plates of sand with a speaker underneath it, where they, it breaks it up into a mandala, you know, and it feels like there's a vibration coming through and breaking down old ideas, old governments, old, it's obviously collapsing. But within that, there seems like something new.
Yeah, and what I would say there is that this is very difficult, I believe, when you have a turnover of an age. I've spoken to a lot of people about this and looked at it, and I think a lot of times when you have a new concept, new idea, new mentality, what I'll call the turnover of an age, there is a lot of resistance to that from the status quo, from the conventional status quo that has vested interest in the old way of thinking, the old order of being, the old society. So they kick and they scream, they fight against it. So there is a lot of resistance, but I think that ties right in with the very concept that there is something new coming forward, something new developing, and like you say, really a new consciousness, if you want to call it a new vibration, a new pattern, and very much a new way, which is, in fact, I would say an old way of thinking. We're going back to our very ancient roots, the concept of the unity of all humanity. More than that, I believe the concept of the unity of all Earth, all creatures on Earth, and that we have to really get back to the concept that we don't destroy, we don't abuse the Earth, we don't abuse ourselves and other organisms, we don't exploit each other and organisms, but we see ourselves as, and I'm a firm believer in this, that we need to see ourselves as a unified whole. And what we do makes a difference. And it really makes a difference. I believe that even what you think, it's this concept that everyone's an individual, the old way of thinking, and you don't influence other people, you don't influence other aspects of the world or the universe. I think that's wrong. There's lots of actually hardcore scientific evidence now that your very consciousness, your very thoughts have an influence, have an effect.
Yeah, I mean, even since the double slit experiment, we know that our consciousness can affect the atoms on a very atomic level. So it only makes sense that, and this is where the internet comes in, because even now, as we're doing this, and it's going to be put on the internet, there is something very mysterious about consciousness. It seems to take part and participate in anything that has the possibility of organizing itself in a coherent, translatable manner. And I think the more we can discuss these things and get them out on the internet and start talking about them, I think it has a subtle effect on that underlying consciousness of the mass of people that are still watching CNN and Fox.
Yeah, and entertaining themselves and being fed, I hate to say it, by a bunch of status quo conventional thinking, which is trying to self-perpetuate. And we really need to change that. I have come to the conclusion that I'm trained very much as a scientist, as a classical scientist, a classical academic. I have a PhD in geology and geophysics. And I have come to the conclusion, as many other scientists who really look deeply into these issues, that ultimately what is sort of at the bottom, what is the foundation of everything, and it's consciousness, it's thought, it's pattern, it's order, it's information. I think these are all variations, if you would, on the theme, but ultimately it's really consciousness that is underlying what we think of as the universe, what we think of as the material world. And this is a very different view, I believe, than the classical mechanistic, materialistic viewpoint that views animals, it views the planet, it even views other people as just material entities that are interacting with each other. So I think we have really two major opposing, competing worldviews, and they are in conflict right now. And I know which one I support and which one I believe is really the worldview that should we say, conforms to ultimate reality, and that is that consciousness really comes before everything else.
Well, as a scientist, I'm sure you're familiar with the chaos theory. And it, right now, it seems like we're in that chaos theory with two systems, the old and the new, trying to reform, with the old trying to restabilize itself. But that's a little bit like being 8 months pregnant and trying to change your mind.
Right, exactly.
We're not going back. We either have to give birth to a new consciousness and a new world, a reality, or we're going to break down in chaotic mess.
I think that's correct. And going back to ancient times, I think this has occurred before, that there have been these changes. There have been these turnovers, should we say, in thinking and mentality and change in consciousness. And I believe that's one of the lessons, if you would, or something that we have to understand when we talk about things like the yuga cycle and the concept of world ages and this very ancient and universal belief that there are world ages, there are changes, major changes from time to time, and mentality and thinking and emphasis and technology that goes with that. So this is, in a sense, something new for us, but when you look at thousands and tens of thousands of years, I believe it's happened before.
Yeah, I believe it has too, Robert. And I wrote a book about the social and neurological consequences of belief systems. Mm-hmm. And while I was writing that, I did a lot of research and interviews with rabbis and biblical scholars, and almost all of them says the same thing. Once you get to a certain academic level, down below, it's unpredictable. But up here, they all agree that it's a story that's been vastly misinterpreted and locked in, because most of our Judeo-Muslim Christian religions are based upon an Iron Age belief that may or may not have happened, and they haven't grown. And this is why it seems like science and religion are hitting a wide gap now, because religion is hanging on tight to dogma, where scientists are going, okay, this is what is, but maybe this is what could be. And scientists are always up for peer review, which this is one reason why I really admire what you've been. I've been following you for years.
Oh, thank you.
And being an academic and having the courage to go out and question even the woo-woo stuff that they talk about, but question it at least to see if maybe we have this wrong. I mean, our whole world is based on beliefs, but what if they're wrong? What if they're wrong? And it seems like they are so diverse and so conflictive and out of touch with what we know about the physical sciences now, it's starting to have a dismantling effect on world religions.
Yeah.
And I see the ones that are reforming with a more scientific view.
Yeah, I think really people talk about the split or division between science and religion. And to me, when you get at that higher level, the deeper level, however one wants to express it, you find that, no, in fact, there is a lot of commonality. And ultimately, you know, there's not this dogmatism. I eschew that dogmatism. We don't need that dogmatism. And also, you mentioned peer review. Peer review, in so many cases, I believe, in the sciences, yes, it serves a certain function, but it also serves a gatekeeper function, where who are the peers? They are the ones that are supporting the status quo and the dogmas of science. I mean, people talk about dogma in religion, it's just as much dogma in science.
Yeah.
That's something we really need to move beyond if we're going to make progress.
This is where the courage comes in, because now you're up against grants and loans and tenure and all this stuff that's coming from these nonprofit organizations that are traditionally really conform to the old paradigm, and they tend to only, you probably know this better than I do, they tend to give money to that which supports the old paradigm, the old regime.
That's absolutely the case, and that's actually something I go into some detail in my forthcoming book, Forgotten Civilization. I actually talk about this quite a bit, because I have felt this personally, very much.
I bet.
That if the safe way to play it in academia, in scientific academia, actually any academia, is to go with the paradigm, and you just make real incremental improvements, if you would, on the paradigm. But you certainly don't pluck the paradigm. You certainly don't look at anomalies. You certainly don't do anything that will fundamentally change the status quo. And so it's a real issue. It's a real problem.
Right. Yeah, and I do see that even in, like, in the science view, like, even evolutionists, I've talked to evolutionists that seem to be locked into this rigid dogma of evolution, and they seem to leave out the fact that there is a missing link. I mean, something happened really quick-like between Homo erectus and Homo sapiens, and there's a gap there. So I'm going to go ahead and ask you this, okay?
No, there's all kinds. I want to say that there are so many anomalies in science. There's so much left out, and I find this all the time. And, you know, textbook science. Well, textbook science is textbook science, and they leave out the anomalies. They leave out the questions, and they make it sound like it's all, you know, settled, and that's that. And it's, when you really get into it, it's not true.
So tell me, Robert. How do you feel about, I'm sure you're a dedicated researcher. Are you willing to take this research back not only to the Sumerian culture, which seemed to pop up, but even further back to the possibility of extraterrestrial intervention, like the Anunnakis and all of that?
Well, that's a tough one. I mean, I honestly, I'll tell you my biases, which is that's not my bias to go that way. I tend to be inclined to look at Earth first. On the other hand, I will say bluntly, if there's good evidence and the evidence points that way, I'm not going to dismiss that. That would go against the grain of what I believe. And ultimately, what I believe is that we have to follow the data. We have to follow the evidence. There's frankly no rational reason why there couldn't have been extraterrestrial intervention. I mean, there's no reason. We are here on Earth. We are intelligent beings. We reach a certain level of technology. I don't think it's inconceivable that you could also have beings on other planets and other solar systems reaching even higher level of technology and intervening. But on the other hand, I want to be clear that I haven't gone there yet, because I have not yet personally been convinced that the evidence needs to go there.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not going to dismiss the possibility either if I am convinced by the evidence.
Okay, so part of your theory is the solar plasma theory, which wiped out previous civilizations. And right now, let's face it, we are so technologically dependent right now on satellites and everything. Even a solar flare could take us way back. So tell me a little bit about this theory.
Yeah, well, basically, there's a lot of different issues here. One thing, I'm a geologist, and one thing that has always been a problem, and, you know, when I was a graduate student at Yale back in the late 70s, early 80s, no one had the answer to how do you have ice ages come and go, the very sudden changes. And back then, we thought sudden geologically might be centuries or thousands of years. Now we know that the changes, these huge climatic shifts, are even quicker. So, for instance, the last ice age ended about 9,700 BC. That's the best dating method, the dating I prefer to use. I won't get into why, but based on the geology, ice cores, sediment cores. And we know that it basically snapped out the last ice age within 3 years. Maybe literally overnight, based on the sediment data. So how do you do that? You can't depend on some kind of gradual climate change. You know, to do it that quickly, there's a lot of evidence now that the sun is unstable. It goes through periods of instability based on isotope data in particular, based on nitrate data, etc. There's a lot of data now that the sun was incredibly unstable at the end of the last ice age, about 12,000 years ago, and seemed to have undergone incredible outbursts, incredible discharges, solar flares, huge solar flares, huge coronal mass ejections, what are known as coronal mass ejections, where it gives off particles and gas, charged particles and electromagnetic fields coming out of the sun, and that these hit Earth with incredible magnitude would have heated up the atmosphere, literally in some cases, probably would have been like huge lightning coming down on Earth. This, I believe, was a mechanism that would melt the glaciers very, very quickly, would put a lot of water into the atmosphere, would cause a lot of precipitation, that would cause increased melting, you know, change the climate very, very quickly. It actually would cause erosion, I believe, maybe even erosion on the Great Sphinx that I've documented and looked at that much earlier age. So much different situation than we see with the relatively stable sun today. And we now know from an astrophysical point of view that stars are very unstable. Our sun is a star, and it goes through periods of stability and instability. What is interesting, and I don't want to be a doomsdayer or someone that suggests, you know, unlikely catastrophic scenarios, that's just not my nature. But when we look at solar activity over the last 12,000 years or so, it was incredibly active. The sun was incredibly active and unstable about 12,000 years ago at the end of the last ice age. It went through a more lull, a period of more stability. And in the last 70 or so years, right up to the present day, it is starting to show a lot of the same activity, a lot of instabilities that we saw 1,000 years ago. And actually, it's interesting to me that just in the last year or so, I have noticed that a lot of people are taking a lot of, they're really giving a lot of attention to solar activity, even on the national news. You turn on the national news on television, and people are talking about solar flares, the latest large solar flare. And we now, as you mentioned, have a modern society built on electronics, built on electricity, the electrical grid, and a major solar flare, much less anything like we saw at the end of the last ice age, could really be devastating to modern society. And we know this is the case, because we had a little inkling of that in 1859. In 1859, there was what's known now as the Carrington event. And the Carrington event was a large solar flare and a coronal mass ejection associated with it. 1859, there's not much electricity in 1859, but there were telegraph lines. There were telegraph lines that were being used with Morse code and that type of thing. When this occurred, the solar flare and coronal mass ejection in 1859, it caused incredible currents to pass through these primitive telegraph lines. It set some of the telegraph stations on fire. People almost electrocuted. It caused incredible devastation, but only to the telegraph lines, because that's essentially all the electricity there was back then. Nowadays, if we had a Carrington level event, you would have massive blackouts for not just the potential. So, you know, I think we have to take these things seriously.
Yeah, and I think one of the reasons, I mean, speaking totally as a layman, so straighten me out, you know, if I say something that you know is different, but it seems like the pyramids were probably built many thousands of years ago, maybe even what we would call the Golden Age, and there was a lot of effort put into that.
Absolutely.
I mean, whether it was done by slaves or however they did it,
I think that was
a lot of effort to make a pyramid, and it seems like embedded into the pyramid is signs pointing to this point in time specifically. And it seems like they would only do that. I mean, let's face it, living way back then, I'm sure they had better things to do than to go around building pyramids. There has to be a reason for it. And it seems like one of the reasons was to tell us, look, pay attention to this time in the age.
Yeah, well, I think you also have that with other legends, if we could. I don't want to use the term legend, with other ancient knowledge. Let's put it that way. For instance, the Mayan calendar, that many people have been talking about the Mayan calendar coming to an end, quote unquote, in this year, 2012, December 21st, 2012. A lot of things, ancient traditions, I use that term at the moment, point to this period in time as being significant, as being something important. Let me focus on the Mayans just for a second, because I think that they tie right in with what you were talking about. They had the concept of different suns, more or less different world ages. And this gets back to our concept of yuga cycles that we'll be talking about next month at the conference. But they had periods of world ages. One of them ends at the end of this very year. Others, you know, the previous one ended about 5,000 years earlier, a bit over 5,000 years earlier. This is not dissimilar to the concept of the processional cycle and things like the age of Pisces, the age of Aquarius. But what's interesting to me as a geologist is that when you start looking at patterns in the actual geological record, for instance, I mentioned ice cores and sediment cores, and you can start looking at climatic patterns, which ultimately tie to the sun and solar instabilities, you see the same periodicity, the same cycles in nature as, for instance, the Mayans or other traditions talk about. So I think this is not coincidental at all. I think that they were very attuned to nature, very attuned to the cosmos around them. And we talked about this earlier today, how the concept of unity, this concept of oneness between all people, but also with nature, I think this is very real for them. And we need to take their traditions, we need to take their prophecies, if I could use that term, very seriously. If we don't, it's to our detriment. So I think there's a lot to learn from the ancient concept of cycles.
Yeah, and the good thing about it is you don't have to totally believe something to take it serious.
Exactly, exactly. Oh, in fact, I'm a great one, I gotta say, and I hope this will come out. I, in some level, don't believe anything, but I take everything seriously, and I want to look at it. I'm not going to, personally, my view is I don't just buy dogma. I just don't buy what people feed me. I really want to look at the data. I really want to give it a fair shake. So I make that decision. Between believing and being open-minded, really looking at the possibilities, looking at the data, and data includes the traditions of the ancient people.
Yeah, in my book, I came out with definitions, and the definition of belief is pretending like you know something that you don't, and eventually forgetting that you were pretending.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, I like that. We get so locked in. And then what happens is when you have a belief and you know it's not grounded in science or experience, you have a tendency to feel insecure with it. And that insecurity comes out as defensiveness and sometimes aggression to protect that belief.
Exactly, exactly, exactly. And sometimes I think you're right. I find that when people protest too much, as they say, when they hold on to belief too much, it is because of insecurity. It's not because there's real data or real basis to support that belief. They feel they have to defend it because they know how weak it ultimately is, whether they know that consciously or that's a subconscious, understanding of it.
So it seems like you've done some reading of Edgar Cayce. So how do you feel about some of his predictions? Didn't he predict that there was a chamber underneath one of the shoulders of the Sphinx?
I got involved with Edgar Cayce on a personal level back in the early 1990s, because when I was working on the Sphinx, and in some circles I'm best known for my work on the Sphinx right up to this day, I, in the early 1990s, was working with John Anthony West, who some people may know, sort of a rogue Egyptologist, and I was brought in initially as a geologist to look at the Sphinx, to look at geological techniques that could date the statue, which there's really no independent Egyptological evidence to date it. There's no inscriptions that say it was built at such and such a time. And, you know, Egyptologists classically thought it was about 2500 BC. Bringing in my geological expertise, I've been able to demonstrate, and that this was 20 years ago now, that the Sphinx, the core body of the Sphinx, goes back to a much, much earlier period. Initially, I thought maybe 5000 BC. Now I'm thinking maybe even the end of the last ice age. But it's much earlier than dynastic Egypt, much earlier than it's supposed to be based on conventional Egyptology, based on conventional historians' point of view. So that gets back to the chamber and Edgar Cayce, because Edgar Cayce, it turns out, suggested that the Sphinx and the pyramids actually go much further back in time than Egyptologists, conventional Egyptologists, acknowledge. He suggested they might go back to 10,500 or so BC, which is in fact the end of the last ice age. He tied them with Atlantis, or at least survivors of Atlantis. He also suggested, Edgar Cayce suggested, in one of his trance states, you know, he got this information. He's really one of the great psychics, of course, of American 20th century. And he suggested, or he relayed information, that there was a hall of records, Atlantean records, somewhere in the vicinity of the Sphinx. I actually did not know this. At least I had put it out of my mind, if I did know it at the time, in the early 1990s, a fellow geophysicist named Thomas DeBecky and myself did seismic studies around the base of the Great Sphinx. What I was looking for was more independent, corroborative evidence, evidence to confirm my dating of the Sphinx, which came back further in time. I wanted to look at subsurface data from mineralogical changes that I could use to help date the Sphinx. And we collected a lot of data, was very successful. It confirmed my earlier scenario, my hypothesis. It confirmed my hypothesis based on other data that the Sphinx goes back much earlier. And this has withstood the test of time for the last 20 plus years, and we've got more data to support that. But when we were doing that seismic work, we found, lo and behold, a chamber on the left jaw of the Sphinx. A fairly large chamber, 5 to 12 meters on a side or so. And at that point, I somehow wasn't really aware of Edgar Cayce's specific predictions about a chamber in the vicinity of the Sphinx. I got a call from my office. I was sitting in my office at Boston University. I got a call from the office of the ARE, the Association for Association for Research and Enlightenment, essentially the Edgar Cayce Foundation, down in Virginia Beach, Virginia. And they had heard about my work. I published, I was not, you know, hiding the work. And they wanted to know about this chamber, and they informed me, well, yes, Edgar Cayce had prophesized, had predicted that there should be a chamber there. Now, when I start looking into it, he says it's a little ambiguous exactly the way he said it. He talks about the right paw of the Sphinx, if I remember correctly. But if you face the Sphinx, it is the right paw. It's on the right side. So I wonder if he was thinking in those terms, because if you put it in context, he's sort of saying, well, when you view the Sphinx, and he talks about from the Nile and the shadow. So we may have even gotten the correct paw. So I don't know what to make of this. I mean,
I noticed when they tried to disprove, they didn't say it was your theory, but when they tried to disprove it, it seems like they drilled down at an angle that would probably have never hit the chamber.
Absolutely did. That's very perceptive to you. You can see it somewhere. I've seen it on YouTube. You've got Mark Lehner and Zahi Hawass. I think this is what you're referring to.
Yeah.
Standing by the paw, they're standing by the left paw. They're drilling down at an angle which is sort of guaranteed not to hit it. because, you know, they missed
it. Where would you like to go from here? What would you like to cover?
Something that Katie just reminded me about is, I don't know if this is worthwhile getting into, but we're talking about the Yuga cycle. We're talking successional ages and changing cycle. Right now, we are at the end, of course, of the age of Pisces and going to age of Aquarius. And that traditionally indicates a change in mentality from more of belief-oriented, religious-oriented belief system to more what I would say maybe understanding, trying to search for the actual answers.
Right. Well, I think it's interesting too that if you interpret the Bible correctly, it says that Jesus will be here till the end of the world, but actually the Hebrew word is end of the ages.
Exactly. And so I think right now we are going through that transition from Pisces to Aquarius, which just really means a different way of thinking about things, a different consciousness, a different approach. Yeah. And some people argue about, well, when's the age of Aquarius going to occur? But I personally think we're in that transition right now, that we're already starting to see that transition.
Yeah, it's not going to happen at 12 noon on a certain date. You know, it's organic in so many ways, and it's hard to say when a flower starts being a flower because it's a gradual process.
Exactly.
So let me see here, Robert. I had a few things I was going to ask you about here.
Anything you like.
Okay. Yeah, we got talking about all kinds of things, huh? You know, I think one of the things that'd be interesting to cover is, and this is something that's sort of I've noticed on a personal level, is the more balanced I can become inside myself as a man, balanced with my feminine energy, the more it clears things up. It's almost like brings things into focus, and it changes how I react and deal with the world. Like as a man with male energy, I would deal with the world like that, just a solid thump. But with feminine energy, I deal with it more like a gentle push. And I've noticed that being married and being in love, I've noticed her energy when it comes at me, I don't notice that it's done its thing until it's over. It's not conflictive. It's not combative. It's like a gentle transformation of whatever it is we're dealing with. Does that make sense to you?
That makes sense to me. And I wonder, I'm thinking as you say that, as we go through this hopefully transition, consciousness transition as a collective group, that maybe we're going from less that combative, male, assertive, dominant force to more cooperation. Again, I think that ties in with the concept of the oneness of the unity. I don't know, maybe in our society it's been more traditional that males are these strong, self-centered, egotistical individuals versus it's been considered more feminine to be cooperative, to be sharing, to work together. I mean, I hate to stereotype too much, but I do see us collectively going more toward that balance, or I hope.
Yeah, one of the things I bring up in my book, I have a whole chapter on women, and I think two things that's been overlooked by the patriarchal organizations are women. Wait till women start waking up and realizing they have power, and the internet. The internet, this is why they want to control it so much. They want to grab hold of the internet because this is how we're going to communicate about these ideas. And they're powerful. Once you have an idea that it's time, and it's starting to shift, I can feel it inside myself. And I remember back, I'm sure you, do you remember when you first started learning how to ride a bike, how difficult it was?
Because
you were doing it with your left brain. You were thinking, oh, I'm falling to the left, so I got to pull it to the right. And it was like awkward, and you fall and fall, but there comes a magical moment of transference and coherence when your body mind takes over. And
right.
All of a sudden you realize that you're not only not falling, you can't. You can't yep. make yourself fall anymore. Something yep. has taken over on a new level of consciousness.
Right. And actually, as you were saying that, I was thinking that when you're first learning, you're thinking about so consciously, so rationally.
Right.
And trying to think every little thing through. And that's when you mess up. That's when you make the mistakes. That's when you falter. Versus if once it's ingrained, once it's fluid, then in a sense you can.
Yeah, and I think this is where the scientific community has become a little bit dogmatized too, because I think we're getting into realms where religion used to have control of that realm. These real right. subtle energies, these spiritual realms and consciousness used to be the C word in science. You didn't even say it. But now it's becoming the focus of a lot of scientific investigation. So
yeah.
I think this balance is coming into play and will eventually probably braid religion and science together in such a way that it will become a new creature of research.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that day. I'm hoping that will be the case. And actually going back in time, you know, then I've very interested in ancient cultures, ancient civilizations, and I believe that they had a different approach, a different way that we can learn from. And traditionally, I believe there was not this dichotomy between science and religion. In fact, we talk about, for instance, I'll call him the Egyptologist who did a lot of work in Egypt, Schwaller de Lubitsch. He talks about the sacred science, where as for me, when I was being trained as a classical academic scientist, to talk about sacred and science, I mean, you didn't even combine those two concepts. I mean, that
right.
they were antithetical versus this whole concept of combining them, I think is really what we need and what we had in previous ages, previous world ages, and different, really different mental apparatus, a different approach to it, which we need to regain.
Yeah, I'm going to take us probably way off the track here for a second, but something that's interested me lately, and this started with a few trips to Bolivia and Brazil. I took ayahuasca, took that journey using plants, you know. Then I remember in a conversation with Fred Allen Wolf, he talked about the fact that that was the main source of him going from a rigid quantum physicist into these other realms, is because it opened up some doors of vision. And lately I've been listening to Graham Hancock and Terrence McKenna. I mean, Graham Hancock, it's changed his whole outlook of what life and reality is about. And,
yeah.
and it seems to me that my few experiences with ayahuasca took me and put me in touch with the mother nature, the organic nature. And I realized at that point that the world, it seems like we've lost touch with the mother nature of Gaia, the world as a living organism. And it appears like we've not only made shamans illegal, you can actually go to prison for doing some of the things that shamans do, where ancient cultures, they were revered, and the culture, the tribe, totally depended on shamans taking sort of some of these plants, whether they were mushrooms or ayahuasca, and going into these other realms and bringing back new information for their evolution in creating their societies and even medicine. What do you feel about that?
Well, okay, there's two comments. I actually have become very interested in shamanism and have been looking into it on many levels. I've actually been looking at, most recently, a lot of the ethnographic literature, for instance, and talking to people and trying to experience things. Just as a side note, I mean, I'm an academic. I almost feel like I'm so much of an academic. I actually have a degree in anthropology, among other things, at right. undergraduate level. So this is not something that's new, sort of a new interest for me. But I have great respect for shamanism, and it does seem to be a tradition that goes way back. What I was going to say is that the classic shamanism at least where we've derived that term from now, is from really the Tungus region, the, you know, Siberian, Mongolian, China, that region. And it's very interesting that a lot of those shaman experiences were actually done, and it's a little bit more difficult to do perhaps, but done without any kind of plants or any kind of intoxication in the sense of ingesting something or taking something in. In fact, they were done in many cases totally by will and consciousness and things like attuning to the earth itself. Something that I've become very interested in is human resonances, for instance. And I believe a lot of shamans traditionally, they were able to attune themselves to the human resonances, which is sometimes referred to as the heartbeat of earth. And actually, I think that, and I don't want to go off on too many tangents here, but for instance, some telepathic experiences, some shamanistic type of experiences are actually, again, I'm an academic, I'm a geophysicist, among other things, are actually carried on human experiences. Some shamanistic type of experiences are actually, again, I'm an academic, I'm a geophysicist, among other things, are actually carried on human frequencies. And we, our brains, are actually attuned to human frequencies. And to, when I say human frequencies, that go with those frequencies. It's also been found, for instance, getting back to ancient sites and ancient cultures, that some of these sites now, work is being done with sound and resonance, and that many of these sites, they will resonate at just the right frequencies to affect mental abilities, to affect psychic abilities. You find this, for instance, in the Great Pyramid. You find this possibly at this very, very ancient site in Turkey, the Bakli Tepe, that goes back to the end of the last ice age. So many of these sites, when you start experimenting with them, and, you know, a lot of traditional archaeologists, they don't even want to talk about this, but they are doing things, I believe, they would be used as a way to carry the mentality, to carry consciousness. They were essentially vehicles to reach higher, what I would call higher states of consciousness, altered states of consciousness.
This could be what's behind some of the tribal dances where they dance for 24 hours. And
absolutely.
Even the sarcophagus in the pyramid, since there was no bodies in it, it makes you wonder, like, was there a vortex of energy there that would transport your consciousness to another place?
Exactly. So, for instance, a lot of tribal dances and whatnot, I believe that the beats in them, the patterns in them, are actually human resonance patterns, you know, beats that are in sympathy with that. And there is a certain aesthetic, but that aesthetic ties in with the natural patterns. I have no doubt, for instance, the sarcophagus, I refer to it as the coffer in the Great Pyramid, that it's not a sarcophagus. No one was ever buried there. I think there's a lot of evidence that really the function of the Great Pyramid was, among other things, ritualistic, for carrying out rituals, for carrying out procedures, should we say, that would alter states of consciousness for those involved with it. Yeah.
I think as we can continue this research and get more secular people involved in archaeology, we're going to escape a lot of the politics involved in Egypt. And Zahiwas, I mean, you don't even bring his name up to Art Bell, but you know, this guy, I think he's been captured in sort of a trap there.
Yeah. I don't know what the latest word on Zahiwas is, so I really don't want to speak to it, but of course he's not in power at the moment, as I understand it, you know, with the turnover of the regime in Egypt. I have understood that, you know, very serious charges. Some people want to bring very serious charges against Saudi Arabia.
He's been in control of that for a long time.
Exactly. I'm hoping that, you know, now that there's a change in regime, change in administration, that we might be able to open up a little bit again, do things that we haven't been able to do for the last 10 or 20 years. Because there's a lot of important research in Egypt. And it's more than just digging up another, you know, new kingdom tomb. I mean, I think it's very fundamental research that needs to be carried out, even if it's unconventional by status quo standards.
That's funny. What brought the regime change about was basically young kids.
Yeah.
They just showed up. That's all they did. They showed up and communicated like this. And the regime got so, they spent millions of dollars trying to control it, couldn't. They ended up getting in touch with their parents and getting all their parents to try to talk to your children because they're being misled. Well, the parents got involved and the kids said, hey, here's what's really happening. Then the parents stayed. So I think we really need to start listening to the younger minds, because I think we forget that even Jesus was like in his mid-20s when he started teaching.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Buddha, all these great teachers were really young when they had their aha moments and set out to change the world. But yet we're sort of stuck with all these old ancient politicians that, you know, I don't even want to go into it, but it seems like they're so out of touch with the transformation that is in process right now.
Right. Well, I think what you said ties right in. The longer they're in power, the more they become status quo, the more vested interest they have in the status quo, in things as they are today. I find this not just among politicians, well, maybe everything's politics, but among scientists, the more vested interest they have, the longer they've spent their career supporting a certain paradigm.
Right.
It's only logical, the more they have vested in that, and they don't want to let go. They do not want to admit that what they've been doing for years might not quite be the truth, might not quite be reality.
You know, this is the importance of breaking down our beliefs, dismantling them, and seeing the eyes through the eye of a child. Like in Zen Buddhism, they talk about this, the beginner's mind. Because if you have in your mind, I'm sure as a scientist, you've run across this. Once you set up a networking cognitive process of believing a certain vision, a certain way of seeing the world, what happens is we get attached to it. And then the filtering process comes in, and you start filtering out anything that conflicts with it, and it's all done unconsciously. Now, all of a sudden, you really believe what you're talking about because your whole world believes that way. And you can say, look at all the evidence, but you don't realize that you've filtered out all of the conflicting evidence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so,
exactly.
So keep that in mind with the extraterrestrials, okay?
I do. And that's why I say, I actually consciously try, now whether I'm always successful or not, but exactly what you said, I try to consciously always say to myself, what are my biases? What evidence might I be filtering
right
out? Where, you know, might I be going wrong? Are there things that I'm missing? And I really do try to be open to things. So like the extraterrestrials, I want to, you know, again, I'm open to it, but
it's just a possibility.
Yeah, exactly. But I haven't personally been convinced that we have to go there yet.
Follow the evidence.
Exactly.
Well, listen, Robert, I could sit here and talk to you all day.
I agree.
I think maybe we could follow this up in Nevada City.
Yes, yes. So, the Youth Cycle Conference.
Yep.
And I don't know, can I put a plug in for my website?
Absolutely. Yeah, I'm going, but do that.
I was going to say, I have a website, personal website, www.robertschoch. And it's spelled Robertschoch. My last name is Schoch. Because I mentioned that because a lot of people misspell. They want to put a K on the end. So www.robertschoch.com. And if people go there, they can read about me. They can find a link to my forthcoming book, Forgotten Civilization, where I actually talk about a number of these issues that we've touched on. I touch on them in the book. And I think it's very important. One thing I try to do in the book is really break down paradigms. I talk about the whole concept of paradigms and ancient civilizations and the status quo approach versus the new approach. I also talk about a lot of new developments in science that tie in with the importance of consciousness underlying everything. So I think a lot of good material people will enjoy.
Yes. Same. Cynthia Fowlis from Inner Traditions got a hold of me and told me, she said, you're going to have to read this book. So I'm first on the list to get a book.
Oh, there you go. Great. Excellent. Yeah. I'm glad to hear that. And the conference, the Yuga Cycle Conference, I hope that people can make it. I'll be speaking there, a number of other speakers. It's going to be a great place to really talk to people about this who are open to it, who are not closed-minded. And this is what we need to do, I think, is really start getting this movement really going, both through the internet, by personal interactions, by promoting and supporting things like Ananda College and Expanding Light, really get this going. We are moving, I have no doubt, we are moving into a new age, new transition, new cycle. But how do you want to say it? The Yuga cycle, we are experiencing that change right now. So I hope people will participate.
We are the change.
I hope so, yeah.
Robert, listen, tell your wife it was nice talking with her, and I look forward to meeting her and introducing you to my wife.
Yes, we likewise look forward to meeting you.
And okay. Keep up the good work, you know.
Thank you.
You know, it's people like you on the front lines of the academia, you know, that are willing to transgress those boundaries. This is what we need. We need to push those boundaries away, you know. Look into these realms.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I agree with you.
All right. You have a nice day.
Okay. You too.
All right. Yeah. Take care.
You too. Thank you.